From the End of Groove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands, my name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my mission is to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion for DJs. And that is exactly what we are going to do today. Because this is my annually complete workflow stream, which will also be recorded on video. And I will edit the waiting times, which are quite severe in my workflow, out so you don't have to wait till something has been started up or quitted. What this workflow will show you is how I convert from one single platform, namely Traktor, to various other DJ platforms. I will convert to Rekordbox, I will convert to Engine Prime, I will convert to Algorithms DJ for iOS. I will even use Mixed in Key in the mix. I will use almost every app I created, because I created these apps because I needed them myself, and I just put a nice user interface on them and made them a little bit easier to use for everybody else. But these are my babies. This is what I needed for my own workflow. First, let me give you the premises. I use iTunes as my basic collection manager. And what does that mean? That means all the ID tree tagging, like artwork, album, artist name, stuff like that, general track metadata is done in iTunes. Another thing I do in iTunes is creating my playlists and folders, so I have a good structure. I can find stuff back easily, and I have some very custom apps which avoid duplicates, etc., which I can't share with you because they got my storage structure deeply hard coded in them, and I cannot simply change that. All my tracks are stored on an external file server, an AppleShare file server, which in the macOS works the same as an external drive. It works exactly identical, which means that the moment I have a problem with my file server, I can use one of the backups, which has the same name as the file server, and my Mac won't notice the difference. It will still think that it's working off the file server while it's the backup drive, actually. I can even use that on location. And of course, every Mac in my network has access to exactly the same track files, which means there is no messing around with tags and stuff set there that doesn't work on the other computer. Everything, every Mac, every computer is using the same tracks. Then we go to the DJ preparation, and I use Traktor for that. But everywhere I use Traktor, you can easily replace that with Virtual DJ, Serato, Rekordbox, because let's face it, at this stage of the game, it doesn't really matter which of the big names you use to do your DJ preparation. They all have their own very special good points, and some have the weaknesses. The reason I am on Traktor is for two reasons. First reason, most important reasons, legacy. I'm a Traktor user ever since it came out, and I like the program. It provides me with everything I need, which isn't said that there are is some stuff missing, but I don't need the stuff that is missing. I'm not very high on the streaming, for instance, because I only believe in streaming if it's either Spotify, Apple Music, or the entire Beatport collection at a reasonable price. Everything else, I don't believe in. So that's what my point of view about streaming. Another important thing, this is my own personal workflow and my own personal view. It isn't said that it is perfect, and maybe it doesn't fit you at all, but I make this workflow so you can maybe pick up some bits and pieces about how I do things to implement in your own workflow. And even if you are not on macOS, but you are on Windows, you can still mimic most of the things I show you, besides my apps, because those are macOS only. But it is basically made to provide you ideas, point of views, and to educate and teach you, of course, about how all this stuff works, how it interoperates with each other. This video and this stream is slightly pre-Catalina, but rest assured, this workflow will remain intact when Catalina is out, because the music app is virtually the same as the iTunes app is. It is missing some features, but it's not a big problem. Everything is overcomable. Everything can be fixed. Every issue that there might be there can be fixed. So it's not an issue to go to Catalina, but I'm doing this on Mojave because this is my production machine. I have already test driven this on Catalina. Let's go to the big screen and let me show you all the stuff that is going on in my workflow. Here we are, and first let me fire up my iTunes. And iTunes, like I told you, is the hub, is the centerpiece of my entire workflow. In iTunes is where I make my playlists, in iTunes is where I set my tags, in iTunes is where it all happens. And I have to mount my server because iTunes right now is trying to find tracks which it can't find. You see that by the exclamation mark, but those tracks are there. If I double click them, they are loading. So just to make sure that iTunes has its stuff in order, there's the server, and you can see the server on the screen right in the right hand top of the screen. That's the file server containing all the tracks. Now, about storage structure. Now we are at the file server. I basically separate a few steps or a few things. First of all, I separate the top 40 or commercial radio tracks from the EDM or dance tracks. And every year I make just one big folder, and that contains all the hits, all the radio hits of that year, all the top 40 hits of that year. And I make a dance folder of that year. Let me show those folders. The first one is in the dance dossier collection. And if you look at Dance 2090, you will see it has a buttload of tracks. There are 4,000 tracks right there at the moment. The same if we go to the top 40 folder. These are top 40s by every year. And this is, for instance, the top 40 2090 folder, 302 tracks at the moment and counting. My customized apps, which I can tell you, take care of making sure there are no duplicates in the playlists. But this storage structure is kind of the centerpiece, the backbone of my whole workflow. I got another workflow where I put my own productions in, my own remixes in. And then finally, there is a workflow where the dance mixes are in, which are the non-stop mixes, the mixtapes if you like to, and where the acapellas are in and stuff like that. So I separate all those streams, and the most important ones are the top 40 collection and the dance dossier collection. Today, I'm going to work off the track or of some freshly downloaded hardstyle tracks. Now, hardstyle is not my kind of music, sorry folks, but it is really a thing among the younger generation in the Netherlands. Basically, hardstyle is the thing going in the Netherlands right now. Before I add tracks to iTunes and process them, the very first thing I do right after the download is drop them on this little thing called the track rename tool. The track rename tool comes with every app I sell. Every app you get the track rename tool for free. And this is a very nifty little thing, because what it does is it will take out all the non-ASCII characters, all the non-standard characters of a file name and replace them with readable ASCII characters. Why is this important? Especially if you are converting between DJ software, each program, each app uses its own way, its own method to decode those characters. And there is no uniform way they all use. It's just a mess, basically. To avoid confusion and to make sure that each app uses the same characters, I make them all ASCII. And how does this work? You simply take a couple of tracks, and let me first show you that with the sample tracks, and just throw them on the track rename tool. It will warn you that the tracks will be renamed. Because of the renaming, their file path will change. And if you want to know more about file path, look at this link right above my head. I explain there why this is so important. So it will change the file path, but since these are just downloaded and not part of any collection yet, it's completely safe to do. Now look at it, what happens to this sample tracks folder the moment I press yes. As you can see, all the non-ASCII characters are replaced by ASCII characters. It's like magic, it's like Google Translate happening on your tracks. For all those people in Greece, for all those people in Turkey, for all those people in Israel who has an Hebrew way of not, use this. Please use this, not for me, but for yourself, because you will experience one day that characters that are non-ASCII in a file path will cause troubles. Another word of caution, if a file folder name or a folder name, a containing folder name, even a drive name contains non-ASCII characters, this problem can still occur. I seriously have seen artists who put emoticons in their file names. So fire for the hot bangers and ice for the cooldown stuff, etc. Don't do that. Don't do that. It will cause problems along the way. Keep it ASCII, keep it simple, then you are safe. All right, having said that, let's do the same thing with the hardstyle tracks on the file server. And there we go. And as you can see, this stuff goes pretty quickly and there was nothing to rename. Oh, there was something to rename there. You can see that in the log file, what was renamed and how it was renamed. The next step is adding those tracks to iTunes. And mind you, those tracks are not on the terabyte yet. These are not on my file server. These tracks are stored on the computer that I use to download my record pools. So they are not there. And my app or my custom script will take care of that. So here we are in iTunes again. I go to the dump folder, and the dump folder in my playlist structure is basically the access, the gateway to my entire collection for every track. I just throw this one in and we wait a little while it's being processed. You can see that happen right now. And once the tracks have been processed, we come at the second stage of my workflow, and that is giving them a star rating. Before I process them, before I even add them to the collection, I go over them and I give them a star rating. I'm going to use a script for that. I made several scripts to give star ratings in iTunes, and those scripts come freely bundled with either the Traktor Q&K tool or the Racketbox Q&K tool, and you can use them for yourself. These scripts are very efficient, which means you will see in a moment that they will automatically jump to the next track which doesn't have a rating, and when they are completely finished, all tracks are rated, it will stop processing. This also gives you an ability to skip through a track using the keyboard, and I love keyboard shortcuts because they speed up the complete process. Let's start, and again, this is not my kind of music, folks, so you will see a lot of low ratings because there is no way I'm going to use them. Talking about ratings, my rating system is very simple. 3 stars is normal, is average, which means I might use this in a set. I might use it. It's okay to stay in the collection. Below 3 stars is not going to happen in my collection. If I give it 2 or 1 stars, I will delete the tracks even before putting them into the collection. 4 and 5 stars is more like, yay, I like them, yay, yay, I like them. So 3 stars average, below 3 out of the collection, 4 or 5 any different version of it's a good track to use. And of course, those star ratings can change over time. I think Despacito once started out with 5 star ratings. I don't think it has 5 star ratings in my collection anymore. Same for, let's say, All Time Road. It's a great track, but maybe a little bit too long in the teeth, so it goes down from 5 to 3 ratings. These ratings can be very useful because when you are mixing and working hard, you can just sort on the ratings and know, oh, I like that track, I like that track. So that's why ratings are important. And the ratings are only set in iTunes. There is no other place I change the ratings, because otherwise the ratings become a mess. If I'm going to change the ratings in Traktor, I'm not going to get them back in iTunes. If I'm going to change them in Rekordbox, I'm not getting them back in iTunes. So I only change ratings. It's part of the basic tagging in iTunes. Let's go. Alright, all tracks have received their ratings, and as you could see, I only used my keyboard for that. There was nothing else I did. The mouse didn't move. It was just all by keyboard and shortcuts, which make this a very quick process. Alright, I told you, everything below 3 is not going to make it to the collection, which means I sort on rating and I select everything that was a 2, which is not so much as I expected, to be honest. And I delete it from the library. Those tracks will be gone and are gone right now. The next step is to bring these tracks to the terabyte and to put them in the Dance 2090 playlist. And let's dive into my playlists. And we see right here Dance 2090. And right now, there are already 4,000 tracks in it. The script I'm going to invoke is not available. I'm really sorry, folks. I wish I could, but it's not available because it got my storage structure deeply coded in it. But the track that is still on, let me show that in the Finder. And if you read the complete path, you see that it is on a drive named HP schijf, which is not the terabyte. And you will see after the script has done its magic, it will be on the terabyte. And the tracks will be part of the Dance 2090 and the dump list will be empty. Let's invoke the script right here. You see below there the download top 100 as well, which is more the commercial and extended version of stuff, which is not for this one. So I just can simply say no, not to the downloads, only to Dance 2090. And you see it are 36 tracks right now because we deleted it for due to the star rating. I will cut this part short. I will speed it up so you don't have to watch a moving cursor all the time. And as you can see, the tracks have been added to the Dance 2090 list. And we see it are 34 tracks, which means that the script automatically detected 2 tracks which were already part of the collection and skipped those tracks. It didn't put those tracks in the collection. It just left them out, which avoids duplicates. I see that the genre is not consistent there, so let's make this art style. And I don't like it to be kept. There we are, hard style. And I've got, and that's something new I did. I made dance subs, which are basically categorized by genre. And I put the hard style in the hard style sub, where they are right now. As you can see, there are my 32 tracks. Oh, I see, I could use some other stuff as well there, but this is fine for now. So the hardstyle is in the hardstyle sub and it's in the Dance 2090 playlist. Let me show you that the dump is indeed entirely empty now because everything has been transferred to the correct place. And let me show you that indeed all those tracks are now on the terabyte. Let me do a show in Finder for you. And let me ask the location, and there it is. It is in the on the terabyte drive instead of the drive it was originally. By the way, those tracks are still on the original drive. I manually have to delete them, and I usually do that when everything is finished. So if we quit iTunes, which I need to do to update the iTunes XML file, and you look in fresh downloads, you'll see the tracks are still there, untouched, all 40, like I said. But those are no longer the tracks I use. I use the tracks on the terabyte. The next step is to add those tracks to Traktor. And as some of you might know, Traktor is a great program, but it's awful with iTunes integration. So what did I do? I wrote an app for that. The app is called TIMP, the Traktor iTunes Merge Playlist. Sorry folks, but I like descriptive names for my apps. So this is just a descriptive name. And TIMP comes bundled with the Traktor queue and key tool, which I will also use later on. As you can see, there are certain tags that are automatically synced. The star ratings is one, the date edit is one, the play count. What I do is, as you could see in the iTunes collection, I will show you that later on. The grouping field holds the actual storage location of the track, so I know from what location the track comes from. So the hard styles I just copied are all in Dance 2090, for instance, and that will be the grouping name. And of course, I want the genres to be synced up. So those things I want to sync to Traktor. It finds automatically the iTunes Music Library XML, and it finds automatically my Traktor collection, which means I can just put it to work and it will show me an overview of all the playlists that are available in iTunes. And I'm going to select which playlists I want to sync with Traktor, and it doesn't matter if those playlists are already there. It doesn't matter if those tracks are already there. TIMP will take care of everything. It will avoid duplicates in the collection. It will make sure that everything is just imported. And the beauty is, you can use non-continuous selections, and you can select just every single playlist, a few playlists, whatever you want, to sync with Traktor. So this is really a really big time saver overall. I need to remember to put a small cam on when I'm on. Thank you for that. All right, here we are, and this is my iTunes collection. And what do I want? I know from experience that I just want the hard style from the Dance 2090 subs and the Dance 2090. And this is the power of this app. You can't do this very easily in Traktor. Then you have to drag and drop and first delete the old playlist before you can do that. Here I just select, I want to have Dance 2090, and I could have the entire subs if I want to. Why not? Let me do that. I take the entire subs and this one, and we go for it. And this is a typical part I will cut short for you. The starting up of Traktor can take close to forever with a collection as big as mine stored on an external drive. I was a little bit too late to the party, but you saw me eject the terabyte, unmount the terabyte from the desktop, and that speeds up the startup incredibly. So, hot tip, if you got your track stored on an external drive, in a server or in the cloud or somewhere else, eject that, unmount that drive, start up Traktor, and then mount the drive again, which I will do right now, to make sure that the tracks will load. And let's dive into my playlists. And first let me show you, hold on, we save no expenses here at the End the Groove Remains production team. I got an overhead cam. And let's switch off my cam, like that. All right, here we are, and I'm a spoiled brat because I use Nexus 2 gear as a controller for my beloved Traktor. I set this up a little bit counterintuitive because right now I only use this deck and I only have one thing. All right, what have we got? First of all, we got inside the Dance by Year, we got the 2090 sub. right there. And you can see the hardstyle sub there. And it's complaining about a lot of tracks missing, but that will be fixed in a moment because those are the tracks available. Those are the new tracks. And if I go to my analyze these first, you can see it's complaining the tracks are missing. However, if we do a check consistency, you will see they are not missing at all and it is fixed. What I also will do in this stage is I will analyze the tracks. So I will say analyze, parallel processing on, have a drink. And while this has been done, I want to go to mix the key next. Now I'm going to take a shortcut, folks, because my tractor takes so long to start up and it's really annoying. I take the shortcut, and this shortcut is I already know which tracks needs to be analyzed in mixing key. Those are the tracks in the analyze these first crate or playlist. So I just drop them inside mixed in key. Another thing of note is please have all your mixed in keys, update tags off, everything off, export cue points off, rename, everything is off. Because next up is the tractor cue and key tool, and the tractor cue and key tool will take care of everything. So I don't want it to be on, I want it to be off. And you can see the countdown at the end, at the lower end of the screen, which is covered by my top overhead cam. You can see the countdown in mixing key in the back. I can already quit tractor. Mixing key is finished, which means I can quit mixing key. And let me clean up the clutter here a little bit. And we start up the tractor cue and key tool. The tractor cue and key tool is your intelligent bridge between mixing key and tractor. It will create a command tag consisting of the key, the BPM, and the energy level with a hashtag symbol in front of it. That key and BPM level will be smartly put, which means if a key is below 10 in value, it will have a 0 in front of it. If a BPM value is below 100, it will have a 0 in it. And that means that this entire command field becomes sortable, and sortable in a good way, which means you have all the keys and then the BPMs and then the energy levels sorted out. If you want something else, you can change it there. This is what I like to use. I leave everything default, but I need to go to the advanced settings because I don't want to process 102,000 tracks. I just want to process the new ones. And for that, I'm going to enter the analyzation offset. And the analyzation offset, the last time I used it, ended at 102,343 tracks, which is a lot, I know, folks. So what I do for safe measures is I enter that number and then just take off like 30 or something for good measures. So it will overlap a little bit, but that's fine by me. It's more important that everything is being analyzed than that it is exactly the number of tracks I did. So this is the offset I'm going to use. I apply the settings, start analyzing. And again, it's time for a drink and I will cut this short. The tractor cue and key tool automatically started tractor and you saw me disconnect the terabyte server just to speed this stuff a bit up. And trust me, this makes a difference, folks. This really is tenfold faster than when I don't disconnect the terabyte server. Let me reconnect it. There we are. And let's dive into that dance, into that hardstyle. And now look at those command field, folks. I'm not sorted on command yet. I'm still sorted on import date, if I'm not mistaken. There we are, on import date. And let's take a track which I actually rated high. That is the Armin van Buuren track, of course. Let me put the fader up. As you can see, those cues are indeed coming from mixed in key. And the number you see between brackets is the energy level of the segment. So if you go through the segments, this is hardstyle, so most likely it's, oh, there's a two. There is a two there. And there's an eight there, and there's a seven there. So you can see it changes a little bit from time to time. That's how this stuff works. Now I told you, look at what the sorting field of the command can do. And if you use it, you can see all of a sudden that everything is grouped together nicely. So you can immediately recognize where what is. And I see a couple of hardstyle BPMs which should be doubled, but fine by me. I'm not that big on hardstyle anyway, as I just told you. All right. We have done this all in Traktor, which means the next stop is going to be the DJ conversion utility to convert everything to Traktor. And in order to do that, I have to export my collection. Click on collection, export the collection. Don't forget to disable the copy tracks to destination and give it an OK. Each time you change something in your Traktor collection, you'll need to do this. This is mandatory if you change something, because otherwise the DJ conversion utility doesn't know about it. I often get the question, Mixmaster G, why do you export a collection? Why don't you use the Traktor NML that is in the native instruments folder? The reason for that is that Traktor has a very complex way of storing its metadata. It can be stored in the track file and it can be stored in the collection file. This way ensures that all the data is stored in the exported collection file. So just picking up the collection file from the Traktor folder, from the native instruments folder, doesn't ensure you get all the data. This does, and that's why it's taking a little bit, because it is comparing stuff inside the tracks, the Traktor tags inside the track files, to what's inside the collection database and determining which is the latest, the newest, the valid one. I quit Traktor here. You gotta love watching this from video instead of the live stream, because this takes forever to quit. But I'm through with Traktor in this workflow. So from here on out, things will be maybe a little bit faster. I start up the DJ conversion utility, and what I will do in the DJ conversion utility is going to RecordBox. I will create a RecordBox XML. We have Traktor as our source, and you see that the collection file, the correct collection file I just exported, is already recognized by the DJ conversion utility. Now, here comes the first trick, folks, in my workflow. I don't want to convert everything. And usually, I know right now that the tracks I want to have are contained in the hardstyle folder, but I don't even, or playlist, but I don't even want to do the entire hardstyle playlist. I just need 32 tracks. And for that, I invented the only tracks after modified after and the date. I just did this yesterday, which means only the tracks of today I need. Usually when I'm jamming, I'm just playing with my tracks. I'm just trying different things out. I'm setting new cues in Traktor, because Traktor is my preparation program. Traktor is where I experiment. Traktor is where I find new combinations, new stuff. If I change cues there, loops there, whatever, the BPMs you just saw that were off, change them. This will automatically find the tracks that I modified, that I played with, because normally I don't know what I have played with and I don't know what I have modified. I just jammed away an evening and did a lot of stuff, and I have no idea which tracks I touched and which need to be synced to the rest of the collection. So this is how you do that. This is how you make sure that only the tracks you have modified after a certain date are converted into the collection. And for me, those are just the hardstyle tracks. Now I hear you think, hey Mixmaster G, I thought we only were going to do 32 tracks. Remember, I made the offset in the Traktor cue and key tool a little bit lower than the actual stop moment from the previous one. That's where the extra tracks come from. They were all tracks processed again by the Traktor cue and key tool. which doesn't delete anything you did in Traktor. If you set loops for those tracks in Traktor, they will still be there. If you set queues for those tracks in Traktor, they will still be there. That's the beauty of using the Traktor Queue and Key tool. It keeps everything you did in Traktor and adds mixed and key keys where possible. All right, this is a new one. This is a warning. I don't know when you view this video, but right now we had Rekordbox 5.6.1 out, and actually yesterday we had 5.7.0 out. Those versions of Rekordbox contain a serious bug if you use conversion software, because those don't import queue and loop and other metadata from an XML file, which is what we are going to use to import the stuff in Rekordbox. To avoid this problem, you have to install version 5.6.0. I made a tutorial about this. Link is right above my head. Watch it if you don't have the slightest idea I am talking about. Important takeaway from this is I'm going to use Rekordbox 5.6.0 to import my stuff in Rekordbox. I have to click this box and I have to click OK, because trust me folks, before I made this message, I got thousands, literally thousands of mails, Facebook messages, tweets, whatever, of users of my tools complaining, Mixmaster G, nothing works, I don't get my queues in, Rec doesn't work, DJ conversion, nothing works anymore. That's correct, everything works fine, Rekordbox is bugged. And the fine people of Pioneer DJ are working hard to fix this. So hopefully if you see this video later in the year, they have already fixed this and it's not an issue anymore. At this moment, it is an issue. We are through with the DJ Converse utility, which means we are going to Rekordbox. And like I told you, I need to go to Rekordbox 5.6.0, which means I cannot simply take a Rekordbox from the dock, because that will fire up Rekordbox 5.7.0. No, I need Rekordbox 5.6.0, so I have to double click it inside my application folder. And of course it will annoy the hell out of me by telling that there is an update. No, I don't need the update. Right here you see all kind of new stuff it found in iTunes automatically. And I'm completely fine by having it automatically analyzed right now by Rekordbox. That's done. The analyzation is running. You see that in the lower part of the screen. And once the analysis is done, we go to the dreadful part. You see there is only one playlist right here in Rekordbox, because I don't use Rekordbox playlists at all. I can even delete this one, because that was one of the last imports I did. Delete the playlist. Thank you very much. I actually use the iTunes part of Rekordbox usually. And if we dive into the Dance EDM part there, and we go to the Dance 2090 subs, there we find our hardstyle part. And the thing is with Rekordbox, yet another bug, sorry folks, I can't help it. The date added column doesn't work in Rekordbox. You can see if you try to sort this on date, it doesn't make any sense. It makes the random sort. How it sorts is anyone's guess. I don't know, but you can see that's basically a mess. So it's very, very, very hard. Oh, there they are. Or not. No. So it's very hard to find the tracks we just added, and they don't have any cues, of course. Looks like we find them right here. Here we are. Those are the new tracks, and those have been analyzed by Rekordbox, because you see that nice little small graphical waveform in front of it, the preview. But right in the preview you see they don't have any cues, and that's because we haven't imported the XML data yet. And what's going to happen here is basically file path mysteries, because those tracks, and if I show it in the finder, let me find one that we can easily recognize. Let's take Home by the Headhunters, why not? And we say show in the finder. There it is. And let's give it a red dot for easy recognition. So you can see Headhunters bij Headhunters Home, die extended mix, from the iTunes view of Racketbox. Has a red dot. Keep that in mind, it has a red dot. Now, let's go to the collection view. And let me try to find, because this is that very big collection. There it is, Home, the extended version. You can see it has 3 stars, exactly as we gave it. You can see it has no cues, exactly because we didn't import it. And if we show it in the Finder, and this is from the collection view, you see the same track with a red dot, because it's the same file path. Now, here comes the trick. Let me close out the iTunes XML and let's open the Racketbox XML. The Racketbox XML is basically a transmission mechanism. It's a way to import and export information out of Racketbox, period. It's not a collection, it's not an entity in itself, it's just a way to in or export stuff out of Racketbox. And if we are going to look for the home track there, let's make this a little bit easier for us, there it is. And you can see Q, which means it contains Q data, but it is still in that transmission mechanism. It's not in Racketbox, so Racketbox doesn't know it has Q data. We know because we can read it right here. And if I show it in the Finder, you see it's that exact red dotted home track, because everything works on with tracks from my file server. So they are all looking at the same track because they all originated from iTunes. And they all come from the same base. And this is important to keep in mind, folks. The easiest way to get playlist information inside Racketbox, and the recommended way, is by right-clicking playlists under the Racketbox XML part. And then click Import Playlist. Now, this is slow. If you think starting up Tractor 3 with my collection is slow, this is even slower. But the good part is, I can leave it. I can just hide Racketbox. It will perform its magic in the background. And I can go to the next step. And the next stage is getting my Tractor data into Serato and into Algorithms DJ. And in order to get it into Algorithms DJ, I take yet another shortcut. The DJ conversion utility, which I'm going to invoke in a moment, requires tracks in DJ to be analyzed by DJ, and they need to be analyzed before they can receive cues, etc. So I need to analyze those tracks. Now, this can be a painful process to do, but you can take another shortcut, and I am going to take that shortcut, and this is how it works. We basically know which tracks needs to be analyzed, because if we go to the song part and we sort it on today, and today is October 3rd, which is also a very big day in my neighbor town Leiden. I take the tracks added October the 3rd and I put them back in dump. So the playlist dump basically contains the tracks which needs to be analyzed in DJ. And that's because I know exactly what those tracks are. If you don't know exactly which tracks needs to be analyzed, you have to do the whole step as shown in the other tutorial going from Racketbox to DJ. Right now, because I know what to do, this is the shortcut. I start up DJ. I navigate to the dump playlist, which contain all those tracks which needs to be analyzed. Remember, select them all and say analyze songs. And lucky for us, the analyzation in DJ is remarkably fast. This was real time. It's really good at doing analysis. And it's very powerful too, because the sync stuff Algorithm DJ can do, really no other software can do. It's very, very powerful stuff, folks. I use it, by the way, as my backup tool. I've got it on my iPhone and I've got it on an iPad, which I will later on sync when we have seen that everything is there. For now, I quit Algorithms DJ and I'm happy that the tracks that I'm going to use are already analyzed, because that will save me a tremendous amount of time. I fire the DJ conversion utility up again, and this time we go from Racketbox. Now, I hear you think, hey, Mixmaster G, you didn't do anything in Rekordbox. You didn't export to XML. You didn't. That's correct, because the Rekordbox XML we are going to use as a source is the exact same Rekordbox XML the DJ conversion utility produced, converting from Traktor to Rekordbox. So we are kind of recycling, building on the work that has already been done. I want to insert Serato Qson loops in those tracks. And here comes a thing what a lot of people of you forget. You have to take the protect existing off if you want to be sure that the tracks receive their new cues and loops. If a track already contains Serato Qson loops in its file tags, it will not automatically be overwritten by converter data. That only happens if you take the protection off. And I think on a weekly basis, I get 10 to 15 users who forget to take that protection off. Take it off. I refuse to make protection off a default because it's a safety guard. It makes sure that you know what you are doing and it ensures that you're not overwriting anything you want to keep. So I keep that on, but don't forget to take it off if it is required. The same with converting to DJ. If a track already got cues inside the DJ collection, then it will not be overwritten by converter data. Only if I take the protection off, it will receive the new cues and loops. So that's a safeguard, folks, and it's in place for that. And you can see the DJCU XML is automatically selected, so I can click Start Conversion. There is a warning because this process is rather intrusive. It writes new tech data to track files. There are no issues known with it, but I just want to make sure that you understand what's going to happen. And of course, as always, have backups, folks. Backups are the lifeblood of a DJ. The whole XML only contains one playlist, and this is the playlist in question. The Reading DJ database can be slow because these are again 101 tracks, so I will cut this short. And here we are again. Both the DJ Pro and Serato were automatically started by the DJ conversion utility. So first, let's dive inside the Dance EDM subs. Let's go to the hardstyle one. And this information is coming directly from iTunes in Algorithms DJ, which makes it such a breeze. And let's take the first track we see, the Don't Stop track, and there you see the cues are all there. They are a bit off. That is an encoder issue, and that will be fixed the next time I use it. I can guarantee you that. But you can see all the cues are there. Again, they are off, but that will be fixed. The next stop, let me show this track inside. There we are. And there you see our home track as well. Because I quit DJ here and I go to Serato, and I'm not a Serato user, but just drop our home track by the headhunters inside, and you see that it already got the cues there, and there they are on again. It's just an encoder mismatch inside. It's just an encoder mismatch inside DJ Pro that was causing that. So those new tracks have now cues in Serato. They have cues in Algorithms DJ Pro Mac OS. I quit a Serato here. And let's have a look at our friend Rekordbox, how it is performing. It's still working there. That's nice. And it should always almost be done. But we're not going to wait for that, because the next stop is the iPad. Because I told you, I'm going to have this information on my iPad as well. Which means, let's go to the overhead cam. And let's make it a little bit bigger there. There we are. Here we got the iPad, and of course tracks are not on it, which means again I have to fire up my iTunes. There it is. connect the iPad and switch it on, of course. That one off. There we are. You can see it's syncing. It's first making its backup and stuff like that. But that's not important right now. What is important is we are going to Denon Prime. And for that, let me get one of my drives and let me make first the screen a little bit bigger so you can all see it. Because I can, I now these days use these drives. And what are these drives? The fun thing of this is I can open it. I can take out the enclosure. And this is a 2 terabyte SSD. Formatted XFAT. And if I hook this up in the enclosure to my SC5000, which are right there, and maybe we take a look at there later, it will show up and I can use it. However, if I just take this one out, I can plug it inside the inner tray of a Prime 4 unit, because it's SATA, and SATA gives you the best possible speed. But if it's in the enclosure, it's USB 3, and it is still pretty fast, it's still pretty quick. So I just leave it in the enclosure. There are no screws there, it's just click and play. It's called an IC box. I can recommend it with a Samsung Evo drive. Works flawless. I've got 3 of these babies, which means I always like to give each player, each individual player, its own drive. I don't like to rely on having a proper link. Sometimes in establishments, the links are not there. The hub is gone, the mixer is not capable, etc., etc. To avoid those kind of problems, always have one drive for each and then one spare. Hence, I've got 3 of these. The same, by the way, for my CDGs. I've got Nexus 2 on my router as my platform, which means I use 500 gigabyte Samsung drives. I will get them out in a minute if Rekordbox is done and sync those up. But first, we are going to use this one and we are going directly from that tractor converter data to this drive without doing anything in Engine Prime besides analyzing the tracks. And the beauty is our BPMs will be exact, our beat grid will be on, everything will be on. Let's go. And there you can see the drive mounted. It's called the Prime drive. And in order to get our stuff on it, we start up the collection backup tool. And the collection backup tool is basically the gateway between the information inside the Rekordbox XML. And remember, that is that Rekordbox XML I produced way at the beginning of this stream, converting from Tractor to Rekordbox XML. That very same Rekordbox XML is used here as well. And my target drive is the Prime drive. What the collection backup tool does is it will see inside that Rekordbox XML which tracks are there. Copy all those tracks to the Prime drive, but in an intelligent way. If those tracks are already on the Prime drive, they won't be copied. Only if they are new or modified, then they will be copied over. After that, the collection backup tool will signal the Denon conversion utility to get to work, and the Denon conversion utility will convert all the queues, loops, BPM, star ratings, everything we have set in Tractor, or actually partly in iTunes and partly in Tractor, will be converted to Engine Prime and will be available to my player. So let's do that. Let's go. And this is real time, by the way, folks, so you can see how fast this is, given all the processes in the back. The Denon conversion utility has been invoked. I'm not doing anything. My hands are totally here. It will automatically start up the Denon conversion utility and do all the things with all the correct settings.
The Denon conversion utility needs your attention.
This is an improvement over the older screen and the robot voice step. In order to get converted data inside the tracks, they need to be analyzed first. Would I do it the other way around, then the converted data will be overwritten by analyzed data, and that's not something you want. So first we have to analyze them and then we can convert them. Now mind you, this Engine Prime collection is 102,000 tracks big. Like you saw, it's my iTunes collection basically, but then on the Prime drive. So that would normally take ages to figure out. However, the Denon conversion utility is smart. It created a special crate. And that special crate is called Analyze These Tracks First. And that crate only contains the tracks that needs to be analyzed. So everything else is fine. And if a track was already analyzed previously by Engine Prime, it's not in that crate. So that crate would be, we don't know, we'll see, a few tracks big. Yes, folks, this is the new Engine Prime. If we dive right there, you see analyze these tracks first. And indeed, there you see our hardcore tracks. If we look for the home track, which is kind of our go-to track now. Why not? Where are you? There it is. And I asked to find it in the Finder. You see the red dot is missing because it's no longer in on the file server. It's on the Prime Drive. Let me show that to you. You see, Prime Drive. There is the home track located. I need to analyze those tracks, and the easy way is just to select them all. Press the Command key and the A key all together, Command A, to select them all. And then right click or Control left click, select Analyze Tracks from the pull down menu, and it will start analyzing. Small tip, I can already quit this, but this is going too fast because the drive is too fast, and this is a very fast Mac. So I just can quit it now, and the Denon Conversion Utility will pick up. If you have more tracks or you have slower gear, you can already prepare Engine Prime to quit. It is in the tutorials, I show it there. But basically when you press quit, you get a dialogue. Are you sure you want to quit? Yes or no? Don't press yes, don't press no. There is a pull down below that, and that pull down can say quit Engine Prime when done. And that means that Engine Prime is automatically quitted when it's done analyzing. But it's done already, so we can fire it up again, and let me show you how this all looks. So we make this one a little bit bigger again, and we dive deep inside. There you see the old tracks modified at or after. Mind you, the playlists are not there yet because Engine Prime doesn't know about our playlists. It only knows about a single playlist, which was in the Rectbox XML, and that was that playlist. So my Dance Subs Hardstyle playlist is still the same it ever was before. But if we take the home track, which is our go-to track now, you see it got all the cues, and look at that grid. Everything is set and ready there. So that's all converted data still from Traktor. Now, I told you we want to have those tracks in the correct playlist. And for that, we are going to do another trick. And this is another shortcut. First, let me show you that really that track, that home track, is not in the playlist unless it should be there from a previous run. But I don't think it's there at all. Let me find that. The Dance 2090 subs. The Hardstyle sub on title. Let's look at the age of home. As you can see, not to be found from Hard Childhood to Hard Drop to Hold On to I Am Hardstyle or something like that. So the home track is not in that list, which is expected because we didn't create the playlists yet. Now here comes the beauty of using the same file path for all the tracks again. We start up the collection backup tool again. And this will be a fast one. I navigated to the iTunes XML, which is buried inside your music library, iTunes, iTunes Music Library XML. That's the one you need as a source in the collection backup tool. I open it, I start backup, and I cannot sync with the Denon Conversion Utility automatically, but that's fine. Here are our settings, but those are fine. Now, the trick behind this is everything in my on my terabyte, everything in my iTunes collection is already on that Prime Drive. Those tracks are already there, so you can see how fast this goes because it doesn't need to copy them because they are already there. The only reason I invoke this step is to create an iTunes Music Library XML on the Prime Drive. And that iTunes Music Library will contain the file paths to the tracks on the Prime Drive instead of on the terabyte. So that's the reason why I need to do this. I need to have an iTunes Music Library XML with the correct file paths to it, so my tools can find the tracks from the Prime Drive instead of from the original location, the terabyte. Collection Backup Tool is done, which means if you look right here, you can see, by the way, and that's a very important feature of my tools, they create safety backups. I read a lot of people having damaged drives online. The most known cause of this is actually the Prime 4. And let me explain to you what happens. A lot of artists are syncing their Prime 4 from the computer. They put stuff on the drive and then they go to the Prime 4 and switch it from computer mode to standalone mode without unmounting it first. That for sure will damage your collection file, your database. Quit Engine Prime, unmount the drive, switch to standalone mode. That should be the right order of things. But I know from a lot of TeamViewer sessions I have with Prime 4 users that what they actually do is just, oh, I'm through, all right, I go to my Prime 4, I click local or standalone use, and all of a sudden their database got damaged. For that reason, I make backups, and because I like to go back in time if needed, and that's also possible. If you look right here, you find an iTunes Music Library which has just been created. And that's the iTunes Music Library with the file path to all the correct tracks. For the rest, it still is that same XML. The fun part is, if I take this drive to another computer and I use Serato and I tell Serato to use the iTunes Music Library on this drive, it will find all the tracks because the file paths are to the drive and the drive contains the tracks. For now, we want to have those playlists in Engine Prime. And for that, I start up the Denon Conversion Utility. And you can see it automatically selects the iTunes Music Library XML because that was the last created XML. I can navigate to Rekordbox XMLs, I can navigate to the DGCU XML, but it automatically defaults to the last created file, which is the iTunes Music Library XML, which makes it logic that you want to use that one. And indeed, we want to use that one. So we say, start conversion. This is the warning that the protection was enabled or disabled, which means that nothing existing is being overwritten. I can basically keep it enabled because I didn't change anything, which will speed up the process. But usually, if you get this message, most of the time you want to disable the protection because you want to override existing metadata in the collection with converted metadata. So that's what this dialog is basically for. It's a warning. And here we are at the part that I can tell which things I want to have in Engine Prime. And because all the tracks are already there and everything is already there, then this will be incredibly fast. I will take the Dance 2090 subs entire folder, which contains the hardstyle folder, but I could also just pinpoint to the hardstyle, and I will take the Dance 2090, the mother folder containing everything Dance brought into the collection at 2090. I click OK, and the Denon Conversion Utility will do its work. And again, this is pretty quick. And the Denon Conversion Utility is done, as you can see. We make things a little bit bigger here, and we dive down inside the Dance EDM sub, and we search for the hardstyle. There we are, and we go to the home track or search for the home track, and there it is, and we load it up, and there it is with the tractor cues and everything ready to be used. So that's how I get my stuff from Traktor into Engine Prime, basically a two-part process. One stage to get the cues, loops and all the DJ metadata in. That's all coming from Traktor. The other stage creating the playlists the tracks are part of, which all comes from iTunes and is very, very fast to implement. So it doesn't take much time to do that all. That's the Engine Prime part. I told you I've got 3 of these drives. In order to have exact duplicates of those drives, I use the excellent Carbon Copy Cloner. No affiliation with it, but the Carbon Copy Cloner is the best way to duplicate drives, to duplicate your startup drive, to duplicate to clone your server, to backup these kind of drives. I even use it to backup or duplicate my CDG USBs. So basically, Carbon Copy Cloner is my go-to copy backup program, and I can highly recommend it, worth any penny. Link below. We go to Rekordbox, and you can see the XML has been imported because it's all quiet there. And once again, if we dive inside the iTunes part now, and we go to the hardstyle part, right there, and we pick up, you see already happening what I want to show you, and we pick the home track. Again, this is a conversion or encoder problem, the shift, and I can guarantee you this will be fixed with the next conversion phase, because I know which encoder home is, so I can easily fix this and avoid these shifts. That's one of the new features of the DJ conversion utility, that if there are MP3 shifts, and these are all MP3 tags, and there is a shift, I can fix it. So that's nice. Another nice thing is that the queues are set both as a hot queue and as a memory queue, which is important if you spin on other gear but a Nexus 2, because most other CDJs don't have 8 queues. They only have 3 hot queues at most, and for the rest you need the memory queue if you want to have gated playback. All explained in the CDJ for beginners tutorial, right at the link right there. I want to sync this with my USB, and that USB is right here. It's a very, very small, nice one. For by Samsung, it's a 500 gigabyte. Like I said, I always recommend 32 gigabyte FAT formatted drives, because that will work everywhere. But since my router says Nexus 2 only, I can hook up 500 gigabyte, and that's what this baby is. Let me find the correct cables and let me hook it up. And I always like to use the sync manager, which will automatically be invoked on this drive right now. And because it's a 500 gigabyte drive, this takes some time, and iTunes is also busy in the back, or actually is finished in the back. So while iTunes is breaking its neck about what needs to be done next, let's put that away. We double check that on the iPad all the information is there. There we are. And let's see that the home track is there, because I'm going to need that in DJ for iPad. Let me get the overhead cam here, or not yet, because of course we don't have the cues and loops of DJ right now on the iPad. The only thing I've got on the iPad are the tracks. And in order to get the cues and loops, which we already had in DJ Mac OS, I dive into the music library and we find the DJ Pro 2 folder. And there you see the DJ Media Library. And that's the thing we need, because that contains our cues, loops, etc. for the tracks. So if I fire up the iFunbox, and the iFunbox is free shareware you can use to get stuff in and out your Apple iPad, and you go to the app sharing part of it. Let's go to DJ 2 first. I use both DJ versions, but DJ 2 is the one I prefer, because it looks so closely to an SL 1200. You see what looks like a file on the Apple looks like a folder on iOS. But these are the same files. These are the same thing. So basically, I just drag the DJ Media Library to the folder right there. The same, let me do it a little bit slower. DJ Pro 2. I dive inside the algorithm folder, and there I replace the DJ Media Library with this one. In the meantime, you can see that RecordBox is done syncing with the USB, which it was doing but not really indicating. So we got a lot of things going on together right now. But I can quit iPhonebox, I can disconnect the iPad, and let me go to the overhead. Let's see if this is visible. Oh, it's kind of. All right, let's fire up DJ. And this is DJ 2, like I told you, because I like that program. It looks so nice. And we go into the hard style, which I am already. And let's find that home track. Let me sort that on. There it is. And you can see it got 3 cues. You see those dots there. And if you go to the cue part, you see them right there. So the cues are already there. I hope it's visible on the cam. The cues are already there. Those are the cues. And the same for DJ Pro, which got 8 cues. So that's why you might want to use that. That's the one. There we are. And now you can see, let's put it up, that it got the 8 cues. That's one of the differences between DJ 2 and DJ Pro. This one got 8, the other one got 2. And again, you can bring up the cue overview. And I can really recommend this, folks. This is really fun to play with. I recommend it to everybody who wants to get into DJing, who wants to get into mixing records. I say, well, just take a subscription to DJ. Take a subscription of Spotify, because Spotify is integrated with DJ. And you got everything to start with. You got everything to play with. One of the drawbacks of using iOS is that this iOS device only has Bluetooth out, or that FireWire connector. However, if you invest heavily into an Apple USB adapter and only take the Apple USB adapter, anything else, and trust me, I've tried all those cheap solutions, they don't work. Only the Apple USB adapter works. And I've got this Logilink soundbox. This is the Logilink 7.1. And the beauty is, this thing provides a separate cue output and a separate master output, which means I can hook up my headset, I can cue properly, I can scratch properly, and I've got a proper master output. It's noisy as hell, but it's a true portable solution. Again, not affiliated, just a tip. Those Logilinks, there are several of them. I've got another one which only has a master output, but this 7.1, and I put the Amazon link in the remarks, has actually both a cue and a master, which makes it a complete portable mixing system. This is the expensive part of it all. This is ridiculously priced, but it's really the only thing that will work. Okay, that's all about Algorithms DJ. Then we go back to RecordBox, and I told you already that my RecordBox drive should have, or my CDG drive should have been synced. So let's double check that. We go to the Dance 2090 subs. We go inside the Hardstyle sub. We look for the home track. There it is. And if we load it up, it will have the same misaligned cues. But again, I will fix that in the next one. And this is coming from the CDJ drive, from the Samsung drive. So this is not a terabyte. This is the Samsung drive. And that's why I'm not able to show it in the Finder, because there is no showing in the Finder. This is the drive I connect to my CDJs, and I've got everything there. The Sync Manager, something you might want to see as well. This is how my Sync Manager looks. As you can see, everything from iTunes is synced to RecordBox. Sometimes that Sync Manager can get confused, which means that all of a sudden playlists in the iTunes part of RecordBox are empty. They don't show tracks, whatever. Usually that means the Sync Manager is messed up. Just switch the Sync Manager up. Off, close the box. And you can say simply yes. It will warn you. And then switch it on again. That's all you need to do. That's all there is to it. And the moment you click this big button, it will check everything and it will sync. This message you will see quite a lot. And usually this means that either a track is not compatible with Rekordbox. Rekordbox cannot read it because it's damaged or it's a non-compatible audio format. Or its file path contains forbidden characters. And there are two important forbidden characters. Forward slash. If those characters are in a track's file path, Rekordbox will not accept it. So, for instance, Axel and Ingrosso, which is usually the triangle written by a forward slash and a backward slash, no way you can get those tracks inside a Rekordbox collection unless you filter that out. This is basically all I want to show you. This is my entire workflow. I know it's a long sheet. I know it's a long take. But all the explaining makes it even longer. And usually I do this stuff. I just press a couple of buttons and I walk away. I go have a drink. I go do some administration. I go do. This is stuff I usually do in the back. It's not something I'm going to sit and wait for. And I recommend the same for you. Don't sit and wait and watch how paint dries, how grass grows, because why should you? If you got any questions, feel free to ask. If you got any suggestions, feel free to ask. If you think, well, I would like to have a tutorial about this or that subject, collection management or conversion for DJs, I'm happy to help you out. Just ask me and I can see what I can do. For now, it's Mixmaster G signing off.